Welcome to the mobile app design session. In this session, we'd like to talk about how designing for mobile apps is different. And understanding that it is different, why is it different? Because mobile devices have different types of capabilities. So we'll discuss some of the details of how they have different types of capabilities and what those differences are, and then finish up by talking about mobile user experience. Mobile users have high expectations because there are a lot of great apps out there, and they now have experienced those, so we really have to change our way of thinking to be able to create great mobile apps. So mobile app development is not your typical development, and it's important that we understand the nuances of this, because now 39% of all online traffic is mobile. This is now up from just a year or two ago when it was about in the low 30s. Now we're at 39% as far as the global average, and not only is more and more of a percentage of online traffic mobile, but when you look at the average person is now using more and more data. So from 2010 all the way up through 2015, you can see this constant increasing amount of data that each person is using through their smartphone. So people are using phones more and more, and those mobile devices are consuming more and more data all of the time. So we need to understand how mobile development is different. And how is it different? Well, obviously we're going to be developing for the device. And a lot of times when we say mobile device, people think mobile phones, but it could also be a tablet. So we do need to think specifically about the type of device, who the users are, and who we are targeting. And then one thing that we can't forget is that this is their device. It has their music, their contents. It has phone numbers and lots of things that are personal to them, and they have it with them all of the time. It's in their pocket. So as they're carrying it around, it becomes something that they really use and are attached to in a very, very personal way. So when we're developing, we need to understand that the conditions are a little different, and the people think about interacting with that device in a slightly different way. So is it really that it's just a small screen because we're on a phone or a tablet? And the answer is no. Not all phones and tablets are small. We now have the phablet and the super large tablets. We even have now some different types of things that look like laptops but have touch screens as well. So it's not necessarily a small screen, but what does change is that the inputs are different. And the fact that most of these things are touch-enabled, and when they're touch-enabled, then the types of inputs are going to be different, whether they're scrolls or the smaller keyboard. There's a lot of changes to the way people can input information. The inputs can also be thought of as being more powerful, because the device has things like knowing its location, it has its GPS, it has an accelerometer and a gyroscope to know the different types of locations it's in and the attitude that it's in, so it knows its orientation. There's a camera for video and image processing. There's the ability to do audio with a microphone and then also play different types of audio. And it has things like near-field communication to be able to work with other types of devices that are nearby. So the inputs are different, and as we're grabbing all of that input, obviously we want to give some sort of feedback. The outputs are different. So we do have that smaller screen, but we can also push notifications and let people know. And a lot of times when we do that, it may actually cause the phone to vibrate. So we do have the ability to vibrate or even play sounds, and those sounds can then notify the user of what's going on. And that can be important because the context in which we're using these devices may be public areas. So we may need some sort of vibration or some sort of audio that might go to the different headphones that we might be using. But we're going to be using this in different types of areas. So some people are using it at home, but most of the time at work, on the go, whether you're at the airport or the store or at school, Wherever you are, people are constantly using their phones. So, if they're constantly using their phones, what are the capabilities of these devices that we should be thinking of? Well, obviously, the typical phone is a little bit slower than the typical laptop. And one of the interesting things lately is that a lot of times the phone or the tablet have as many or more pixels than our desktop device does. So we have a slightly less powerful processor with less memory, significantly less memory, and it's trying to display the same number of pixels to go ahead and do all of the work. Now, while it's trying to do all of that work, obviously it's trying to display information in the browser or through the JavaScript engine. And while it's doing that work, some of these different types of engines and browsers are faster than others. So you can see that the laptop does it very, very quickly, the iPhone a little bit slower, and then some of the phablets or even tablets can be significantly slower. So it depends on the type of device as well as the browser and the JavaScript engine that it's using directly. So we can worry a little bit about that, but we also need to worry about the network. And just because we have 4G in some places doesn't mean that 4G is available everywhere. So a lot of people think 4G is going to be the standard, so there are no performance problems anymore, and that can be a very bad assumption, because there are a lot of different types of networks, and 4G, although is the best, and it's not even the best anymore, it is something that isn't available everywhere. So LTE isn't everywhere, and when it's not available, then we actually step down to 3G or 2G. So you can see that most of the time we're working on 2G or 3G from a worldwide perspective, and even in the US, 3G is much more apparent than others. So 70% of the time our connection isn't 4G LTE, so that can really be a problem. Now, understanding that we may not get the fastest connection, what are some of the other network problems or network issues that we should understand? And when you think about our devices connecting to the network, we connect to a cell tower that then connects to some controllers that eventually get us to the point where we go through a firewall and connect to the internet. So the question becomes, how many phones are using a particular tower? And when the tower connects, how many different types of support nodes or gateways are between us and the internet? And how big of a pipe do we have to send data from the different types of nodes that we're working on? Well, it's important to know those types of things, but one of the things that is going to be true no matter what is that when we connect to any of the servers through the towers, there's going to be some latency on the front end of being able to kind of do the handshake and make sure everything is fine. When we think about desktop computers and being able to make requests, we typically have 20 to 150 millisecond latencies, so the average is only 80. When you look at mobile phones, it's much worse than that. So mobile devices have anywhere from 50 to 550 milliseconds of latency, and then the download begins. So there is a lot more time spent waiting for the connection and talking back and forth to the server. Now, why is that important? Well, when you think about requesting a particular screen, the screen may have lots of CSS, lots of JavaScript, some images, different types of fonts, and other types of things. So if a particular screen has 71 requests that need to be made, if it's a web page and each of these have an average of 80 milliseconds latency, well, those 80 milliseconds really don't add up to that much. And it, depending on the number of connections we have, a lot of these can begin loading somewhat simultaneously. When we think about phones, jumping that latency up to over 300 milliseconds and knowing that the phone will probably be on some sort of network that it's sharing with lots of other devices, it may not be able to open many different channels. So we may be limited to only 4 requests at a time or 8 requests at a time, and that means that it will have to wait for a number of these. So having lots of requests on a particular screen can cause the load time to go way up and really hurt the overall user experience. So we need to understand how many resources are on a particular screen that we're working with and how much data is going to flow back and forth because the network is somewhat limited. So we've tried to think about how people are going to begin using their devices and what they do, what the actual technical networks and hardware experience is going to be, but what about the overall user experience? A lot of mobile apps have been created and a number of mobile apps are considered failures. Well, why do mobile apps that get created fail? Well, over 60% of the reasons of why people say their mobile app failed were user experience related, in that we didn't understand the user, we didn't get the right features in, and it didn't really engage the mobile user the way they had hoped. So a lot of these are user experience problems. So when we design for mobile apps, we need to remember that it can be used at any place at any time. It is portable so that at any given moment we could get interrupted, and that means that we'll stop using the app or we'll be distracted, and when our attention is fragmented, the session will be very, very short. In general, you have to think about creating apps that a six-year-old can use, and then your design will probably work for any of the users that can be distracted as they're walking down the street trying to work with your app with one thumb. So, speaking of walking down the street, when you think about interacting with a mobile device, we're going to be using it with our hands. Sometimes people will use one hand, some people will use two hands. So you can see that on the phone, it's about half and half. And when we say half and half, some people use it with one hand and some people with two, but even the two-handed people do it a little bit differently. And the same thing is true with the tablets. So if we're holding the tablet in landscape mode versus portrait mode, we may interact with the tablet in a different way. So it's important to think about how our users will be using our apps and on what kind of target device they're going to be working with. So when we say that we're going to be working with our devices using our hands, well, if we think about it in a little more detail, it's really with our fingers, and our fingers are much bigger than we expect. A baby's finger is about 7 millimeters, and a pro basketball player's fingers are somewhere down in the 19 or 20 millimeter size, but the average person has about a 11 millimeter index finger, and that means that we need to give a certain amount of padding, usually about 2 millimeters or 10 pixels, in between any of the areas that we wish to target for touch. Because the fingers are so big, they can't be any more precise, and you need to have space in between these to make sure that we don't get incorrect clicks or incorrect touches. So that's one set of problems, and then the other set of problems is a lot of times when we're working and we're thinking about our web approach, we could go ahead and highlight a piece of text very easily, and then we could go ahead and alter that text. If you think about trying to do the same thing with a phone, going ahead and clicking at one particular part of the sentence and then highlighting things is much more difficult. And trying to do cut and copy or paste and have access to all of these pieces, it's going to have to be a lot bigger because the size of the finger and touching these individual controls, these will be too small to be able to do that. So we really have to think about design and alter our design on how that works. Now, when we say we're going to be using it with our fingers, sometimes it's actually our thumb. And we said that you may be using it with one hand or two hands. And if you're using it specifically, if you believe a good majority of your users will be using one hand, it's important to think about, well, on the screen, where in the real estate should most of our things be? And down at the bottom, it's easy to get to things, and it's not too hard to stretch to most of the screen. But there are certain parts of the screen we either can't reach, or it's actually painful to kind of move our thumb in that direction to be able to do that. And depending on which device and how big the device is, you can see that the amount of area that we have trouble getting to can really increase quite a bit. Now, as we're building for the device, a lot of people will say, okay, well, you know, we already have a website, so let's just use responsive web design. And Ethan Marcotte went out and basically said that responsive web design will not serve as the perfect replacement for mobile websites. And what he's really saying there is that when we target mobile and we optimize it, the performance of that site and the way in which it's going to work, the user experience is going to be vastly different. So responsive web design and just reusing our current website, making it responsive, may not create the type of experience that our users are looking for. And part of the reason for that is that mobile apps have now begun adopting a number of different mobile patterns that help make up the screens and improve the user interface and the interactions that the users have. So there are a lot of very interesting patterns that have emerged, things like the carousel, things like the accordion and the timeline are things that you've probably seen before and are familiar with because they are that prevalent in mobile applications. One other thing to think about is that we have the difference between personal applications and work apps. So there are B2C apps where we are consumers and they're distributed as apps in public stores, and they have really great user interfaces because people know that individual people are going to be using them, and we have to persuade them that we have a great app and that they're really going to enjoy the experience. Many times on our business to enterprise apps, they're distributed internally to employees, and the thought is that we can invest less in the user experience because it is a enterprise app. The problem with that is that these days, in a lot of places, we have our bring your own device type of policy, and the user will be able to use their own device, or the user will compare the experience to what they're used to on their device, which means that a lot of our B2E apps that are built for the enterprise are going to be compared or running right next to a typical B2C app. So the user expectation is very high and they're going to compare that app, so it's important that that app is still designed well and makes sense. So when we're designing the different parts of our app, one thing we should always remember is designing for perceived performance. And why do we say perceived performance instead of just designing for performance? Well, we want to design for good performance, but we may have different types of information that is readily available. Why not put the information we do have on the screen as quickly as possible and then go ahead and load the rest of the information when it's available? So perceived performance is about how it appears to perform, not necessarily how it is performing. So sometimes it's displaying some data keeps the users sort of distracted and happy while they're reading that information. We can begin loading the other information asynchronously as needed. So when we think about designing a mobile user experience, remember that it is a smaller screen, so we're not going to be able to fit it all, and that responsive web design won't always work. So we need to be able to target the mobile experience really well. To do that targeting, we need to know who our user is and what they're trying to do. And when you begin thinking about a design, a lot of times you will put in a lot of features, and you really need to go back and think about your user and remove as many things as they don't absolutely need. Because we're on a smaller device with a little bit less power, we may want to make sure that our app is as focused as possible because their expectations for performance and usability are very high. So for us to be able to design a mobile app, we may want to think about this overall experience and storyboard it out and make sure that we understand the navigation and the transitions between pages and understand that really well, because that's going to have a huge effect on the overall user experience. So in general, we have to really shift the way we're thinking about designing applications, because mobile apps will take a lot more work and are a lot different than what we may have experienced in other places. So in this section, we talked about how designing mobile apps is different because people think about them differently. The devices have different capabilities, and we want the overall user experience to be really good because expectations are high, and to be able to generate that type of great experience, we really have to change the way we're thinking and understand a lot of new dimensions that are affecting that overall experience.